The 50th Wexford, where have the years gone? Well, it all started with a gramophone recital that Sir Compton Mackenzie, founder of the Gramophone magazine and a witty and erudite writer on music, had been persuaded to give to the Wexford Opera Study Circle in November 1950 during a visit to Ireland. The chairman of the circle, Dr. Tom Welsh, an opera enthusiast, to put it mildly, struck up an excellent relationship with him. Sir Compton suggested they should stage an opera in their little theatre instead of just listening to records. A while later, Dr. Tom came across the programme for the 1949 Glyndebourne Festival during a visit to a London bookshop and talked about trying out a local version with his friends, Dr. Des French, Eugene McCarthy, owner of White's Hotel, and Seamus O'Dwyer, a postal worker with an enormous operatic knowledge. Despite falling short of their fundraising, they went ahead with a festival of music and the arts from the 21st of October to the 4th of November, of which the highlight was a production of Balfe's The Rose of Castile on the first four nights of November. The opera has also been honoured by James Joyce himself, a tenor of some ability, in Ulysses, in a terrible, typically Joycean pun, when one character sings, "'Twas rank and fame." What opera resembles a railway line? The Rose of Castile. See the whiz? Rose of Cast Steel. Ouch. And there are also frequent references to the boys of Wexford and Joyce, a trifle prophetic perhaps. Michael Balfe was a Wexford man himself, though born in Dublin, and had a huge success as a baritone in Italy, as well as becoming the most prolific of composers for the London operatic stage in the mid-19th century. We're fortunate that Radio Éireann, as we then were there on November 1st, 1951, to record this historic occasion and catch the opening bars of The Rose, with the innkeeper sung by Dr. Tom's delightful sister, the late Nellie Welsh. Scene of The Rose of Castile. Balfe's opera had its premiere at the Lyceum Theatre in London in October 1837. It involves a complicated plot with mixed identities. Leon is ruled by a beautiful young queen, Elvira, who has been travelling incognito around the countryside. The villain tries to marry her off to a peasant, who eventually turns out to be the Prince of Castile in disguise. So Elvira not only holds her throne in Leon, but also becomes the Rose of Castile. And how has the prince disguised himself? Well, I'll let Murray Dickey tell you.
I am. Don't let me introduce
myself. I am a simple muleteer, not too particular to rule. I treat the world both far and near as roughly as I treat my muse, as I treat my muse. If they attempt to give me laws, to give me laws, treat up a plans without good force, without good force. When I bid them to not stop, declare my course is clear, declare my letter as to stop, declare my course is clear. My way is clear, click, clack. My way is clear, click, clack. My way is clear, I am a mule. Here.
Dickey as the Prince of Castile, disguised as the muleteer Manuel, on the first night of the Rose of Castile in Wexford 50 years ago. His queen was a young lady he'd shortly marry, Maureen Springer. Not the festival's last romance by any means. Here she is, from the same production, revelling in the successful outcome of the story. Springer on the first night of the first Wexford Festival in 1951. The Radio Éireann Light Orchestra was conducted by Dermot O'Hara. At the end, two distinguished figures came on stage, the then Minister for Posts and Telegraphs, Erskine Childers, and the man whose visit had precipitated the whole mad project, Compton Mackenzie.
I'm not going to keep you from the pleasure of hearing that grand and one of the last of the aristocratic rebels, Mr. Compton Mackenzie. I hope he'll be bringing with him the south wind of his eloquence. those of you who know his books. I have simply come to congratulate the artists here tonight for the magnificent display, magnificent show they have given us. I congratulate the orchestra, Mr. O'Hara, and all the people who have helped to make the Arts Festival a success. I came down here because I wanted to witness for myself the plan which has now been in operation for some time, which is growing rather slowly to fruition, whereby the Radio Erin Symphony Orchestra and the Light Orchestra collaborate with local groups. And I came down to see how successful it could be. And I have had very great pleasure in witnessing this splendid example of collaboration. It is my wish that both the orchestras should be out of Dublin as often as is possible, going around the country. If someday, it's a rather wishful thinking, if we have to have two orchestras, two large orchestras and two small orchestras, I hope we'll find the means to do it if this excursion abroad to the provinces of Ireland succeeds as I wish it to succeed. I think I'm not telling you any secret if I should announce that if, for example, you would like later on to have the large symphony orchestra, it would be most improper for me to name the very, very small sum that would have to be collected, because we're always in financial straits in Radio Erin. The very small sum would have to be collected by the committee that has been so successful in this work to have the large symphony orchestra play either a popular program or a very classical program or a mixture of both for you in whatever theatre would be convenient for that purpose. I'm not going to keep you any longer now from Mr. Compton Mackenzie, and once more I wish to congratulate everyone concerned for a splendid performance.
Well, Mr. Minister, Reverend Fathers, Mr. Chairman, Reverend Fathers, ladies and gentlemen, well, it's been a really grand evening. I think that, first of all, we must admit. And the first thing I'm going to say is to thank everybody. The singers, the scene painters, the costume makers, the producer, the orchestra. Now, have I left anything out? Well, everybody, anyway, the lighting, everything. It's been an absolutely grand evening. For me, in a way, it's rather an emotional evening, really, because I look back, before I came here, before I crossed last night, I looked up to see when my grandfather first played in the south of Ireland. And I find it was in 1835, that's 116 years ago. That's a very long, long way back. And he played in Waterford, and he played in Cork. He played in Dublin, but I should like to say he played in Wexford. I should like to say he played on these very boards in which I'm standing at this moment. But I don't think it would be quite true. And even under the romantic influence of Balfe, the King of Castile and the Queen of Leon and everything else, I don't think I really can make that claim. However, he certainly played not very far away from here, 116 years ago. And in any way, these old theatres, whether of Ireland or England or Scotland, such of them as remain, when you think how much they've held human pleasure and human emotion in the past, how much of our grandfathers and great-grandfathers, and mothers and fathers sat here in this kind of theatre, enjoyed this kind of play or opera such as we've listened to tonight. You can't afford, you know, to laugh at that kind of opera. I know it's fashionable. I know only the other day when Sir Thomas Beecham put on a magnificent performance of The Bohemian Girl, all the critics got together and felt it wasn't quite a gentlemanly kind of thing to do. This stage of human civilization, which is so remarkable at the present. I felt it was rather letting the side down. The wonderful world in which we live was being rather let down by it. Well, now, it's very easy, of course, for critics, because, as you know, critics of plays, unlike the critics of books, cannot get together quite the same. Critics of plays always get to a bar, whether serving lemonade or whether it's serving whiskey. But they get to the bar and they look at one another after the first act, the question. Each face turns into a note of interrogation, and they, I think not, you see, and then it's a unanimous vote. And then, of course, that's very encouraging to a critic, just as it is, I suppose, to a politician, really, to get a unanimous vote. And they feel then, well, this is wonderful, we really are right. And so they decide that Sir Thomas Beecham and Mr. Balfe and all the people who sang in it and the orchestra and everything else, it's just a waste of time. But it wasn't, was it? I'm sure some of you heard that in the third programme. The third programme doesn't usually indulge in anything quite so light. And it's very unfortunate because, as I said, we were celebrating the fifth anniversary of the third programme the other day, and I was taking part in a debate for overseas, not for Western Europe, but for America or far away or the Far East. And I said to Harmon Griswood, who's the entrepreneur of the third programme, I said, you really must occasionally have something pleasant and agreeable for people to listen to, because what happens now is that people tune in by mistake to the third programme. Then they hear this rather sort of, rather filth. Then they shut off very quickly. And use the return ticket to much binding in the mall. So I said to him, why don't you occasionally have something which people can listen to by accident when they turn on this? Oh, well, that's rather like, well, he said we had the Bohemian Girl, exactly as if he'd said, well, we had the very lowest kind of form of entertainment is possible for anybody. Think of putting on, and we often do. Well, that's what they feel, and that's very largely due to this silly self-conscious business at the present day of thinking that. Well, now, we've all enjoyed ourselves this evening. I'm perfectly sure there isn't a single person in this house who hasn't enjoyed it. Of course, all opera is nonsense, if you like to be. I mean, we just don't believe it really happened, but then we don't believe a lot of things really happen when we get in front of them. I don't always believe that Western films are absolutely passionately realistic. But I like to see people taking six shots and shooting all around the place. I find that, to me, it fills me. And when I saw the King of Castile come on like this tonight, I knew we were foiled, you see. Well, I enjoy that, and I'm perfectly sure you've all enjoyed it. I know you've all enjoyed it. And now I've got to say a word about the man who's, here he is, look at him. I've got to say something. I'll take you into my confidence for a moment. Last year, he talked to me as we drove along back to Dublin, talked to me about the future and his plans and what he was going to do. And he said, I suppose, he said, we shall have to do Balfe first, you see. But I knew perfectly well he was thinking of the whole of the ring, do you see. There he was, you know, lounged up there with the Valkyrie riding along the Valkyrie song. Singing with Tristan and Isolde in the Liebestodt and all this modern business. Well, he's had this beautiful thing. And next year, and I'm going to pin him to this already, sitting up there, I said, why don't you do now Sonnambula next year? La Sonnambula, Bellini. I've kept him off the ring, you'll see at the present. He's not really... I think it's too ambitious at the moment, the whole of the ring. I think Tannhäuser might be managed, but not the whole of the ring. I don't think, and you mustn't let him just get quite so swollen-headed as that. He deserves, he should be swollen-headed, because he's performed really a miracle, because everybody knows, I'm sure everybody here sitting, standing behind and everybody in front knows what it means to produce such a good evening.
A rather sudden ending there for Compton Mackenzie, but I suspect that the speeches were only caught at all because the engineer allowed the tape to run on at the end of the performance, and at that point the reel simply ran out of tape. Anyhow, whatever the circumstances, it's marvellous to have even that glimpse of the first night at Wexford. Sir Compton became the president of the festival and remained so up to his death in 1972 in his 90th year. It took until 1954 for Bellini's opera to be staged, with Marilyn Cotlow as the sleepwalking Adina and Nicola Monti as her confused fiancé Elvino. In the aftermath of the war, the musical world was only pulling itself together again, particularly in Italy. So Dr. Tom could take his summer holidays and head off to Milan and recruit a top-line team for that autumn. Visitors like Nicola Monti, Afropoli, Franco Calabresi and Paolo Padani found themselves in the tiny theatre, alongside such rising British and Irish stars as Heather Harper, Bernadette Grevy, Thomas Hemsley and Geraint Evans. His interest in the less well-known operas soon led him to choose works not in general production, giving Wexford a distinctive stamp all of its own. This in turn attracted leading international critics, including the hugely influential Desmond Shaw Taylor from London, and they were quick to tell the world of the rich pickings to be found on the banks of the River Slaney each autumn. During its first decade, Wexford offered an increasingly enthusiastic and knowledgeable audience such rarities as Lort Sings Der Wildschütz with Heather Harper and Thomas Hemsley, and Donizetti's Anna Bolena with Firenze Cossotto and Plinio Clabassi, alongside such better-known, though at that time still obscure, works as La Sonnambula, as Compton Mackenzie had suggested in his first night speech, and Rossini's L'Italiana in Algerie with April Cantillo and Paolo Montesarlo. Brian Balkwill, Charles McCarris and John Pritchard were among the young conductors, working with such subsequently famous producers as Peter Abert and Anthony Besh, and designers like Osbert Lancaster and Micheál MacLeamore. The results for that day were electrifying, and the festival was soon attracting leading operatic talent, both new and established. Unfortunately, not all the tapes from the early productions have survived the early days, but I think it's worth dipping into the 1956 production of Flotow's Marta, as we're having our second Flotow opera this year, Alessandro Stradella. Here's the German tenor, Josef Traxel, with the most famous number from that opera, apart from The Last Rose, of course, sung properly in German. Brian Balkwill is the conductor.
Oh.
Joseph Traxel recorded in 1956 when he was just 40. He had sung in the world premiere of Richard Strauss's opera Die Liebe der Danae at Salzburg in 1952 and became a leading tenor in both Mozart and Wagner. He died quite young, 19 years later. The cast of Marta also included Marco Rottmüller, Gisela Vivarelli and Constance Shacklock. For its first season in 1951, the festival committee had thousands of paper chrysanthemums made to cover the worst of the many cracks in the building. Having acquired the theatre in the late 1950s, the committee, with its limited resources, could only work slowly on cleaning and restoration. As the success of the venture gathered momentum, plans were drawn up to build a new opera house. One scheme would have moved it to the north side of the river at Ferrybank, beside the main bridge, but building costs, at around £50,000, were too high. Instead, a reconstruction appeal was launched with the help from the Irish Tourist Board. Towards the end of the decade, Sir Alfred Byte, who had settled in Rusborough House in County Wicklow, became involved in the festival. He persuaded the Gulbenkian Foundation to provide £15,000 as the main source of funding. The scale of the work prevented a 1960 season taking place, so the festival is always 1 year younger than its calendar date suggests. The reopening saw Verdi's Hernani in late September 1961. Problems in obtaining the Radio Éireann Light Orchestra, now the RTE Concert Orchestra, led to the involvement of the Liverpool Philharmonic for this one season. The next year, the Radio Éireann Symphony, now the National Symphony Orchestra of Ireland, moved into the pit, a role it maintained up to last year. National and international talents were nicely combined in Mascagni's L'Amico Fritz, a charming lyrical comedy that no one seems to stage anymore, more's the pity. It tells the story of Fritz, a wealthy bachelor farmer in Alsace, who claims he's impervious to women's charms, but finally falls for Suzelle. He has his first intimations of love when he helps her pick the cherries. The 1962 production, designed by Reginald Woolley, a Wexford regular in the 1960s, was conducted by Antonio Tonini. Suzelle and Fritz were sung by Veronica Dunn, and a tenor who made a huge impression at Wexford since his first appearance in the Lizard Amore in 1952, Nicola Monti. Here they are in part of the lovely cherry duet.
Oh,
Veronica Dunn and Nicola Monti in the 1962 production of Mascagni's L'Amico Fritz. The opera has a trouser role for a mezzo. He's Beppe, a pal of Fritz, and he taunts him with a song he's written, a song about a beautiful girl haunting his dreams. In this production, Beppe was sung by Bernadette Grevy. Bernadette Grevy with Beppe's song from Ascani's L'Amico Fritz, recorded at Wexford in 1962. Bellini also made his second appearance at the festival in 1962. I Puritani was not often seen in those days, and Peter Ebert's production, with sets by Reginald Woolley, conducted by Gunnar Stern, drew considerable attention, particularly because Elvira was being sung by an exciting new talent. Marilla Franey came from Modena and had appeared at Glyndebourne in 1960. In 1962, she made both her only Wexford appearance and her debut at La Scala as Mimi, the start of a great international career. Here she is in the Cabaglietta of Chi la voce sua soave, the heroine's mad scene. Thankfully, she's restored to her senses before the opera ends. thunderous applause there for Merle Franey in 1962. The 1960s saw the expansion of French opera, which would play a huge role in the festival's future. The first matinee to be seen came in 1965, with the remarkable Belgrade bass Miroslav Cengulovic as Cervantes' Dotty Knight, a role he'd also scored a great hit in at the opening of the Théâtre des Nations in Paris in 1957. This was the first of a whole matinee series, reaching its seventh opera with this year's Sappho. Another important first occurred with this production. It was the debut of a young conductor from Prague, Albert Rosen. He became such an important figure in the Theatre Royal, clocking up more Wexford productions than anybody else, 18 all told. Of course, he was also to become the principal conductor of the RT Symphony Orchestra, now the National Symphony Orchestra, and was conductor laureate at the time of his death in 1997. Here's the Don dealing with a bunch of bandits who take pity on the old knight. Miroslav Cengulovic as Massenet's Don Quixote in 1965, with Giuseppe Sorbello as the bandit. Another French rarity at the time was Gounod's Roméo et Juliette, a work that's been staged more frequently in recent years. David Lloyd Jones conducted it in a production by John Cox, with charming sets by Cork designer Patrick Murray. Here are the closing bars of the opera. Roméo has taken poison, thinking Juliet is dead, but she comes out of her coma too late to save him. As he collapses, she stabs herself, and they die in each other's arms. The star-crossed lovers are sung by Zuleika Sack and Jean Bratzy.
left of the...
Zuleika Sack and Jean Bratzi as Romeo and Juliet in Gounod's opera, staged in 1967. Dr. Thom had continued to exercise his skills into the 1960s, but made the unexpected decision to step down after the 1967 season. The post was advertised, and Walter Legg, the great record producer, was a surprise candidate. However, Legg had a heart attack, though he recovered and lived on till 1979, and withdrew his application. Instead, a young 26-year-old former Trinity College student, Brian Dickey, was appointed. He'd been with the Glyndebourne Touring Opera and had brought a fresh approach to programme planning and soon demonstrated a gift for finding the right voices. One singer he brought back from the previous year was a young tenor, who was to become a favourite over the next decade, both at the festival and with the Dublin Grand Opera Society in the Gaiety Theatre, Ugo Benelli. Born in Genoa, he made his debut at the Piccolo Scala in 1960. And went on to star in many productions across Italy and at Glyndebourne and Covent Garden. In more recent years, he's returned to Ireland on a number of occasions to give masterclasses and impart both his lovely timbre and his exuberant stage presence. He revelled in comic roles, such as Nencio in Haydn's burlesque L'Infedeltà delusa, Infidelity Prevented, first performed in Esterhazy in 1773. In a complicated triangle, Nencio is being plied with wine by a drunken German soldier who's actually the girl who loves him in disguise. Those who were there remember how hilarious Eugenia Ratti was in this role. Anyhow, here's Benelli doing what he did so hilariously, appearing to get drunk on stage.
Thank you.
Uwe Benelli in Haydn's L'Infedeltà Delusa at Wexford in 1969. David Lloyd Jones conducted, and Mark Elder was the harpsichordist. Dickey continued the exploration of the French repertory and in 1970 staged an opera that was famous for a duet and a coloratura aria, but otherwise was little known, Delibes' exotic Indian concoction Lakme. David Lloyd Jones was in the pit again, and we had the first of three visits from a stunning lady from Martinique, Christiane Ada Pierre. She had a hugely successful career in Paris subsequently and took part in the premiere of Messiaen's St. Francis opera in 1983. However, we remember her best for effortless coloratura, as we can hear in the famous Bell Song. Ada Pierre bringing down the house in the 1970 production of Lakme. She was to return for another French role, Leila, in Bizet's The Pearl Fishers, the following year, and finally for Bellini's Il Pirata in 1972. Brian Dickey fulfilled his early promise with such imaginative strokes as Janáček's Katya Kabanova in 1972, in a memorable production by the young David Pountney, with Albert Rosen in the pit again, and the appearance of the gigantic Finnish bass Matti Salminen in Glinka's Ivan Susanin the following year, the minor role of a messenger being taken in that opera by the young Denis O'Neill. With his remarkable success, particularly in one so young, Dickey was soon persuaded back to Glyndebourne. His successor, in 1974, Thompson Smiley, had been publicity officer at Scottish Opera, and his Celtic charm provided a complete contrast to the often abrasive Dickey. He maintained the three-opera format, for the first time defining them as comprising a singer's opera, a comedy, and a thinking piece. He picked up on the Massenet trail and staged Thaïs in his first season, in a production by Jeremy Sutcliffe, conducted by Jacques Delacote. Another exotic lady, who'd sung in the Haydn opera in 1969, returned for the title role, Jill Gomez. Thaïs is a famous courtesan who's at first reviled by a fanatical priest until he too falls under her spell. Here's part of her mirror aria.
Thank you.
Jill Gomez as the courtesan admiring her own beauty in the mirror aria from Massenet's Thais, recorded at Wexford in 1974. The other operas that year were Mahler's Medea in Corinto and The Barber of Baghdad by Peter Cornelius. A minor role was sung in Thais by a young Dublin mezzo, Anne Murray, and she returned to Wexford in a principal part the following year, before heading to London and international fame. We haven't heard her at the festival or in any staged opera production in Ireland since, Covent Garden, the Met, Salzburg and Vienna becoming her venues. She took part in Wexford's only Baroque opera, Cavalli's Eritrea, directed by the festival's one lady conductor, Jane Glover, who'd also prepared the performing edition. She returned the following year to conduct Gluck's Orfeo e Euridice. It was a distinguished cast with such names as Anne Pashley, Ian Caddy, and no less than two countertenors, Paul Eastwood and John York Skinner. The main tenor was a young English singer, already making a name for himself, Philip Langridge. The outcome of the production being that he and Anne Murray married sometime afterwards. Here they are as the operatic lovers of Laodicea and Eurymedonte, and the opera was sung in English. And Philip Langridge in Cavalli's Eritrea, presented at the 1975 season, in a year that also saw Lalo's Le Roi Dix and Rossini's La Pietra del Paragone. 1976 brought us a memorable version of Britten's The Turn of the Screw, in a stunning production by Adrian Slack, with sets by David Fielding under the baton of Albert Rosen, with the part of Miles being taken by Wexford boy soprano James Maguire. It was accompanied by Verdi's Joan of Arc and Nicolai's The Merry Wives of Windsor, sung in English, with Michael Langdon as the Fat Knight.
Oh, but first, a merry song to keep us in good measure. Yeah. When I was only a tiny boy, with a hey-ho, the wind and the rain, wine was then my joy, for the rain.
every glass and heart.
Aye.
Every man say aye.
Aye.
1, 2,
Michael Langdon and friends in Nicolai's The Merry Wives of Windsor. The next year, life of course returned for the extraordinary production of Marschner's Hans Heiling, directed by Stephen Pimlott and designed by David Fielding, with Albert Rosen in the pit. Set probably in an asylum, with Heiling imagining all the fairy elements, it was quite revolutionary for Wexford and caused something of a stir, though there was no doubt that in life of course a major new talent has been discovered. He was back again for Massenet's Le Jongleur de Notre Dame in 1984, and then in 1986 as the enigmatic fiddler in Engelbert Humperdinck's atmospheric fairy tale Königskinder, under the baton of Albert Rosen, with Michael McCaffrey producing, in sets designed by Di Seymour. Daniela Bechley was the moving goose girl, and Pauline Tinsley returned to the stage as the witch. Few will forget the end of this opera. The witch's poison loaf has killed the young lovers, the goose girl and the prince, in the forest, and the fiddler mourns their ending and, with the children's chorus, places the bodies on a litter to bring them back home. Sergei Leifakus in the closing bars of Humperdinck's Königskinder in 1986. The same year saw the one appearance of an American tenor, who's since become a leading Rossini specialist, Bruce Ford. Indeed, the role of Arrigo in Tancredi was his first Rossini role. He moved on to Pesaro, starting up a link with that festival, which would bear special fruit 8 years later.
Thank you.
the remarkable Bruce Ford in the 1986 production of Rossini's Tancredi, conducted by Arnold Erstmann. The next 1990 mixed old and new, with Boieldieu's charming opera comique, La Dame Blanche, Leoncavallo's Verismo piece, Zaza, and a contemporary opera, The Rising of the Moon, by Nicholas Moore, a rather corny Irish comedy with some decidedly raucous music, not a popular success. Gluck's comedy, Le Rencontre Imprévu, and a setting of The Taming of the Shrew, by German composer Hermann Goetz, Die Widerspenstigen Zemung, were featured in 1991, alongside a Donizetti opera, L'Assedio di Calais, The Siege of Calais, a story of how the city held out against the English invasion in 1347, when six of the town's burghers went to the scaffold in exchange for the relief of the siege. Alison Browner was a remarkable Aurelio, a trouser role, and the first to volunteer for the sacrifice. Fortunately, the English king is impressed by their courage and spares them. But here they are, praying as they go, or so they believe, to their death. The end of the second act of Donizetti's The Siege of Calais, with Alison Browner and the cast and chorus, conducted by Elvino Pido. 1992 brought more Marschner and Mascagni, and a 1786 comedy, L'Equivoce, by English composer Stephen Storrs, who with his sister worked in Vienna with Mozart. Indeed, the libretto was by Lorenzo da Ponte. The following year, we had the controversial production of Paisiello's original version of The Barber of Seville, well ahead of Rossini, with some strangely clad, or were they naked, figures. And for the first time, a Tchaikovsky opera. This was his comedy Chervichki, originally staged as Vakula the Smith in 1874, under the baton of a name that would soon become familiar, Alexander Anisimov. Vakula the Smith loves Oksana, but she won't marry him unless she can have a pair of slippers like those of the Tsarina, the Chervichki of the title. Thanks to the machinations of a friendly devil, he is magically flown to St. Petersburg and meets the Tsarina, who gives him a pair of her Chervichki, and he then wins Oksana's hand back home. Here's the closing bars of the opera, with the tenor Roman Zimbla as Vakula presenting the Chervichki to Oksana, sung by Marina Levitt. She tells him she'd accept him even without them, after all. Her father, sung by the Russian bass Vladimir Maturin, tells her she made a wise choice, as the opera ends with cheers all round.
Не бойся, браво, что я замечал, но подойти до своего благословения поцелуйтесь. Оженим вас, живите, поживайте, любите, сопрощи наживайте. Эй, душевы, всего вы помощи, эй, капсали,
Closing bars of Tchaikovsky's Cherviki at the 1993 festival, conducted by Alexander Anisimov.